Our next speaker is George Gilder, and I'll tell you, he gave a very good speech at the American Enterprise Institute on his book called The Israel Test, which it was just a delight to listen to, and I expect the same right now.
Well, I feel a little daunted, surrounded by all these experts, but I'm encouraged by the, because I'm not an expert on the Middle East. I'm an expert on semiconductor technology, supply side economics, family policy, various issues I've been writing about over the decades. But I came to Israel as an issue very late in my life, virtually in my 70s, on the verge of my 70s. And as I looked upon this phenomenon, it seemed to me that virtually everything I'd been reading about it for decades was not just slightly in error, it was just totally misconceived and ridiculous. And I must say, the idea of a Palestinian state today is just an utter absurdity. The notion that this is somehow tenable, that a group that has recently just been sending Grad missiles targeted at the Ascalon desalinization plant that supplies all the water to Gaza, their own water, should be awarded with a nation state that has been devoted since its origins in al-Husseini, the Grand Mufti, and Hitler's consultant on the Holocaust. I mean, it's just bizarre. And then we have Mahmoud Abbas, who's supposedly a moderate, and a moderate in among the Palestinians is somebody who is unsure whether to deny celebrate the Holocaust or deny its existence. This is just an absurdity, and the degree of the absurdity became evident to me when I read a book recently, after writing The Israel Test, by a man named Walter Loudermilk. And I was giving a speech at a synagogue in Toronto, and after it, a man came up very timorously to me and said, "You really should read this book." And he passed me this beat-up, dog-eared little green text by Walter Loudermilk, and it was called The Promise of Palestine, and it was written in 1939. And I recommend that all of you read it. It really is pretty dispositive of most of the issues and claims that persist to this day. Because what Walter Loudermilk was a Christian, married to a missionary, and he became chief of research at essentially what was the Department of Agriculture in the Roosevelt administration. And he was sent on a global tour he was an expert on soil reclamation and water management. And he was sent on a tour of the countries of the world, really, to determine ways what the ancient civilizations had to tell us about how to address water crises in the United States, and the Dust Bowl and the gullied agriculture of the South had created a crisis in the United States in the 30s. And Loudermilk went all around the world. He was an expert on China, and he finally came to Palestine in 1939, and he was astonished by what he found there. And he went through the demography of the situation, and And what he showed was that the 500,000 Israeli or Jewish immigrants, this is before the creation of Israel, had essentially created Palestine. That is, had retrieved this country that had been totally depleted of its soils. Half the soil on the hillsides had been eroded away. Much of what now are orchards and amazing agricultural industry with sand dunes, and it was malarial swamps. There were just relatively few Arabs, and most of them were sick. And he was really distressed by this discovery, and he showed, however, that the miraculous and amazing innovative agricultural and soil reclamation achievements of the Israeli settlers working on just 6% or something of the land had vastly expanded the capability of the Palestine area to support a population. And he, after 12, it once was a land of milk and honey with millions of people, and it had deteriorated over 1,000 years into essentially a wasteland. And the Israeli settlers retrieved this land and made it possible for it to support a significant population. And he clinched his argument with a comparison to Jordan, which he showed as a soil expert, was better endowed than Palestine with agricultural potential, and it's essentially the same Jordan River Valley and the same configuration of mountains and geological features, and yet Jordan had one-fifth the agricultural output of Palestine, just these Arab settlers, and one-tenth the population density of Palestine. That, in other words, he showed that the Jewish settlers actually created this country, that you couldn't contemplate 5 million Arabs living in this area without the heroic and unprecedented achievements of reclamation and water management and public hygiene and electrification and that these first Jewish settlers achieved. They essentially created this nation. There was none. And as they created prosperity, there was migration from other parts of the Arab world to take advantage of the huge opportunities that these few Jewish settlers created. So the Arab population steadily grew with a slight dip during the after the 48 war, but this whole notion, which I have piles of books that document in all sorts of mendacious detail, that somehow Israelis displaced Palestinians, is just preposterous on the basis of demographic numbers. The more Israeli settlers, the more Palestinians migrated, and the Israeli spearhead of creativity and accomplishment created the possibility of Palestine supporting a population of Arabs, and that it's just all the Nakba nonsense is just just bizarre. There wouldn't be any. There is no Palestinian nation except Jordan, and I believe that the Israelis have negotiated with these people far too long. Why they think they got any claim? Tell them to go negotiate with the Jordanians and the Syrians. Forget. Why do you have to talk to somebody who believes they can make an agreement with Hamas? I mean, it's just a fundamental absurdity. So, I think all American policy is really distorted by this view that. That there's something else of significance in the Middle East beside Israel. You know, this whole that you know, I'm a venture capitalist now, apart from when I'm not writing books, and I go around the country finding opportunities in high technology. And 20 years ago or 30 years ago, when I started this, I always went to Silicon Valley. Silicon Valley is in the doldrums today. It's angling for green subsidies from the Obama administration. It's infatuated with social networking trivia, and it is no longer contributing substantially to the crucial foundations of new technology on which the prosperity and defense of the United States is completely dependent. Yesterday, I spent in Dallas going on from one luxurious headquarters after another of various oil millionaires and billionaires with a just marvelous Israeli entrepreneur who created a crucial technology that enabled the creation of the Iron Dome, which is a defense against rockets that Israel has uniquely developed with the support and help of the United States. But the crucial technologies came from Israel. And that's where I go to find new technology, fundamental advances. It's in Israel, and it is the vital asset in the Middle East, but it's also the vital asset of world capitalism. It's the spearhead of world capitalism today, and the thing is, our adversaries know it. Our enemies know that there is nothing more important in the world than Israel. They are right. They aren't wrong. They know that if the jihad defeats Israel, it will defeat the West. That the demoralization and decay that already afflicts the West will, in fact, spread and endanger all Western civilization. By defeating Israel, our enemies, the jihadists, know they can decapitate Western civilization. And we should understand this. There isn't anything more important over there. And I think it's objectively true. It's going to be increasingly understood that the American high-tech economy, which is the foundation of Western defense, has for 20 years been heavily dependent on Israeli innovations and is more dependent today than ever before. And particularly our defenses are drones and predators and all those technologies that are critical to our nation originate in Israel. And this, you know, we talk, or we, you know, Afghanistan and Iraq and all these other countries, there are current huge expenditure of effort in the Middle East is rendered incoherent by a failure to acknowledge that the crucial asset is Israel. And I think that's of vital recognition. And if we understand this fact, we can understand better how to have a coherent and meaningful and successful foreign policy. I think that Winston Churchill, again back in 1939, the triumph of Israel has been greater than anybody could have anticipated, and I think I'm very optimistic about the future because I think everybody's preoccupied with trivia, you know, what Fayyad thinks about high tech. These are really absurdities. And Israel's ascent in the world is accelerating today, and its imports increased 29% in the first quarter. I mean, it's just incredibly surging and expanding economy and technological spearhead of the West. Nonetheless, for all the modern feats and achievements, I think Winston Churchill summed it up in 1939 in a speech in Parliament responding to efforts to withdraw British support for a Jewish state. Describing the magnificent work which the Jewish colonists have done, he said, "They have made the desert bloom, started a score of thriving industries, founded a great city on a barren shore." Is actually a malarial swamp. Harnessed the Jordan and spread its electricity throughout the land. So far from being persecuted, the Arabs have crowded into the country, this is the general principle, and multiplied till their population has increased more than even all world Jewry could lift up the Jewish population. No displacement. Now we are asked to decree that all this is to stop and all this is to come to an end. We're asked to believe, and this is not Churchill, that somehow Israel is too big rather than too small. I mean, only in Washington can they believe this tiny country the size of Vermont is somehow too big and needs to amputate land, the one thing it doesn't have much of, in order to acquire peace from a Nazi movement. That's the essence of Washington's policy. And Churchill said, "We are now asked to submit, and this is what rankles most with me, to an agitation which is fed with foreign money." The biggest recipients of foreign aid in the world are the Palestinian Arabs, and ceaselessly inflamed by Nazi and fascist propaganda. And this was is mutatis mutandis. It's now UN world globalistic propaganda, but it has the same roots. Thank you.
Laurie? Now, before we have our break, we'll have Farid Ghadry, of the Reform Party of Syria, give us a few words, then we'll break for coffee or whatever we're going to break for. I don't know. 10 minutes, okay. That's what it'll be.
10 minutes.
Yes, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Harold. Thank you, Laurie. And thank you, Asaf.